Next item that we want to talk about is the force reactions from contacts and other boundary conditions. These are generally very useful in verifying the simulation results, as one can check the forces transferred to different parts of the assembly and see how they balance each other out. Force reactions can be extracted using force probes that can be scoped to several items, such as edges or faces via geometry selection, or from boundary conditions such as supports and displacements, remote points, and many more options. This probe grabs all the nodes that fall under the scoping and reports back the summation of their forces. One can create a force reaction probe by dragging and dropping the object under solution. Pay attention to the scoped objects though. If the contact or boundary condition is scoped to a geometry which has a part of it, such as an edge or a vertex shared with another boundary condition or load, then the resultant reaction force may be a combination of them. In case of contacts, there are two sides, namely the contact and the target sides. The force probe uses the nodes from the contact side as default, but it provides the option of picking the target side if needed. But to be able to retrieve these results, one must turn on writing this data to the results file prior to running the model. Now, to understand why force reactions are useful, let's revisit the bracket problem, replace the contact between the wall and the bracket with the bonded contact, as we discussed at the start of the lesson. In this case, when we look at the reaction forces near the contact, we notice that it has a reaction force in the normal direction, meaning that it is supporting the applied external load, and these bolts are no longer supporting any load. So, using these results to assess the impact of their pretension will lead us to wrong engineering decisions. This is just one example, but force reaction probes can be very handy in doing a sanity check to verify most simulation results. Next, let's look at contour plots for stresses and strains. Stresses and strains are usually the quantities of interest for most structural analysis, including the preloaded bolted joints. These quantities can help us identify the regions in the model that are developing highest stresses or strains and are prone to failure. Having this knowledge can help us in performing subsequent calculations, such as safety factor studies or fatigue studies. In case of stresses in bolts, this knowledge can help the engineer identify if the bolt is close to or beyond its proof load during operation. It's pretty straightforward to extract stresses in solid bodies in Ansys Mechanical. After the solution is completed, right-click on solution, go to stress, and insert the metric of stress that you're looking for. You may choose between equivalent stresses or individual normal and shear components, or even principal stresses. The same applies to strains as well. If we are interested in extracting stresses in the bolt, the procedure may differ based on how you model the bolts. For bolts modeled using solid elements, the procedure is same as any other solid body. If the bolt is modeled using beam connections, then one can use a user-defined result to extract the results in it. If the bolt is modeled as a line body, then one can use the beam tool to extract stresses in it. Notice that the stresses that can be extracted from solid elements are more detailed compared to beam elements. This is due to the fundamental difference in the way these elements are formulated. And this is also the reason why we recommend using solid elements for modeling bolt if accuracy in stresses in bolts is of interest. Another quantity that complements stresses and strains in identifying regions that are prone to failure are deformations. This is nothing but the nodal displacements. So, they help us identify the regions that undergo most deformation. When we plot the deformation in a bolt with preload defined, we'll notice the sudden jump in displacement midway. This is where the bolt is split in half, and this is expected. When we exaggerate the result by scaling, we can notice how it collapses into itself to create the state of pretension. This behavior is expected. In fact, if we don't see the two halves moving towards each other, then it's an indication that bolt preload is not applied properly. It's possible that the bolt axial movement is restricted at the cut, so this is a good check to always perform. Now, let's talk about results relating to contacts. These are not specific to preloaded bolted joints, but they are commonly used in these analyses. One such quantity is the contact pressure. When two parts are held together by a preloaded bolt, the preload is distributed over the area of contact between the bodies, and this creates a contact pressure. Contact pressure can be useful in assessing the performance of shear joints and is commonly used to gauge the performance of seals and gaskets, where the sealing pressure is created by preloaded bolts. The contact pressure shows how much pressure a joint can support before opening the contact. Generally, the minimum contact pressure indicates the maximum internal pressure it can support before opening. This quantity, along with contact status, helps us identify if the contact is fully closed or if it's in a sliding or sticking state. Such information can help engineers in making design iterations to achieve the engineering goals. The contact-related results are also very helpful in verifying the simulation results. We already discussed about contact forces, but there are other quantities too, and let's explore them now. To understand this, let's talk about contact in bolted joints. In a bolted joint, contact occurs at three locations: between the bolt head and the first mating component, between the two mating components, and between the second mating component and the nut. If we represent each of these contacts using a spring with stiffness equal to the contact stiffness, then all the contacts in a bolted joint can be represented as three springs in series. The force acting on this spring system is nothing but the bolt preload P. Now, recall that the bolt adjustment is defined as the change in its grip length when it is tightened. If the contact penetration is equal to zero, then the bolt adjustment is equal to the total deformation of the mating parts, which is the ideal case. But numerically, there is some non-zero penetration between the contacting parts, and this results in some inaccuracy in the calculation of the bolt adjustment. Therefore, if the contact penetration is very large, then this makes the calculation of bolt adjustment incorrect, which in turn results in inaccurate contact forces. In such simulations, although the forces are balanced, the contact stresses calculated are inaccurate. In cases where contact stress distribution is a critical parameter for design evaluation, this inaccuracy will lead to wrong engineering decisions. In Ansys Mechanical, the contact tool can be used for post-processing such results. It can extract results such as contact penetration and gaps, which can be used to verify the simulation results. We can either extract them for all the contact pairs or a few selected ones. This selection can be done by scoping the contact tool to worksheet, which will list all the available contact pairs. There's no general rule of thumb, but a good practice is to check that the maximum penetration is at least an order of magnitude less than the adjustment in the bolt pretension probe. If we notice that the penetration is too high, then we can increase the contact stiffness under the contact details. Increasing the contact stiffness will reduce the penetration and therefore makes the simulation more accurate. Another way of fixing this issue is by refining the mesh in those contact regions. This indirectly increases the contact stiffness and also makes the results more accurate in that region. Of course, exercise caution to make sure that the mesh is not too fine or the contact stiffness is not too high to maintain the efficiency of the model. A good way of making such judgment is to monitor the maximum contact stiffness and the resultant penetration for a contact using the contact tracker tool. In this example, we can see that the penetration increases when the contact stiffness reduces during the simulation. This tool can help us estimate the factor by which we may need to increase or decrease the contact stiffness to get an accurate and efficient simulation result.